Hello, and welcome to the complete Five Nights at Freddy's lore. This video tries to explain the story behind the successful franchise. Do not take this as the official timeline. It all starts with William Afton and his family, with also Henry Emily and his daughter. The two men are close friends who know robotics, so one day they decide to open a diner with animatronic mascots. Fredbear and Spring Bonnie are the first animatronics they have created. They are spring lock suits. A spring lock suit is a special animatronic that can be used as both an animatronic and suit. In order to turn the animatronic into suit mode, you will require a special crank which pushes the endoskeleton and mechanical gears to the sides of the suit, making just enough space to wedge a person inside. After Fredbear's family diner opened in the late 70s or early 80s, it became popular and was a huge success. Years later in 1983, William and Henry create the Fazbear Entertainment Company, and with that, a new location, Freddy Fazbear's Pizza. This new location has new animatronic characters: Freddy Fazbear, Bonnie the Rabbit / Bunny, Chica the Chicken, Foxy the Pirate Fox, and a security puppet. William's youngest son, who we still don't know the name but who we will call Evan, is bullied by his brother Michael because he's scared of the animatronics. The day of Evan's birthday at Fredbear's, Michael and his friends force Evan to go to Fredbear. When they're in front of the bear, they decide to put him in Fredbear's jaws as a joke. After having his head crushed, the child dies in a hospital, while Michael regrets what he's done. Fredbear's family diner closes after the incident. One night, Henry's daughter Charlotte gets kicked out of Freddy's by other bullies. Meanwhile, William is passing by. He sees Charlotte and gets closer to her. However, William kills her. For the puppet, who is programmed to protect her in that moment, is too late, but it decides to go outside to find her. The rain breaks the puppet, and in its last moments, it finds Charlotte and deactivates near her body. And it was in that moment that Charlotte's soul possessed the puppet. She was William's first victim, as Henry says.
A wound first inflicted on me.
Years later in 1985, William kills five children while wearing a Spring Bonnie suit to gain their trust. The first one is Susie, a child who lost her dog. William lures her in the location, saying that the dog isn't really dead and that it's inside. After killing the children, he stuffs them into the animatronic suits. The puppet then helps them to possess the animatronics. After the incident, the location closes. After a while, William realizes that the animatronics are possessed, so he discovers something really powerful, Remnant. The Remnant is described as a molten liquid metal made from possessed stuff, which if injected into an object, can make said object possessed. Strong emotional energy such as agony is also considered Remnant, as it can make objects haunted and sometimes create entities. William Afton creates a new location called Circus Baby's Pizza World to continue his killings and experiments. The main mascot is Circus Baby, who is programmed to kill. William wants to use Remnant to gain immortality. However, the location opened for only one day, as William's daughter, Elizabeth, went too close to Baby, resulting in her death. Some years later in 1987, Henry and William aren't associated with the franchise anymore, but Fazbear Entertainment is still active. A new location opens with new versions of the animatronics, while the old ones are left to rot in a room. William sneaks in the pizzeria and kills five more children. The puppet then tells Withered Freddy to save them. They most likely possess the toy animatronics, and the location goes under investigation after the incident.
Okay, so just to update you, there's been somewhat of an investigation going on. We may end up having to close for a few days, I don't know. I want to emphasize, though, that it's really just a precaution. Fazbear Entertainment denies any wrongdoing. These things happen sometimes. It'll all get sorted out in a few days. Just keep an eye on things, and I'll keep you posted.
These are pre-recorded messages because the phone guy says that this is your new summer job.
Hello? Hello, and welcome to your new summer job at the new and improved Freddy Fazbear Pizza.
But the game takes place in November. Jeremy Fitzgerald works as a security guard in this location for 6 nights until he gets moved to the day shift. That day an animatronic bites his frontal lobe, but he survives without it. That event is known as the Bite of 87. The pizzeria closes, the toy animatronics get scrapped and the old ones are kept for future plans. In 1988 a new and cheaper location opens, the withered animatronics are reused and remodeled, and the location lasts until 1993. Phone guy gets killed and Michael Afton works here with the name Mike Schmidt. However, he gets fired after his 7th night for tampering with the animatronics and odor. This is not the first time something like this happened. Back in FNAF 2 a man named Fritz Smith was fired for the same reasons after only one night. He could be Michael too. The location closes because it was not doing well and gets abandoned. After the location gets abandoned, William comes back and destroys the animatronics. He takes Remnant from them and injects it into his creations, the Funtime animatronics.
Small souls trapped in prisons of my making, now set to new purpose, and used in ways I never thought imaginable. He lured them all back to a familiar place, back with familiar tricks. He brought them all together. Are they still aware? I hope not.
He then sends Michael to an underground location called Circus Baby's Entertainment and Rental to save Elizabeth somehow. When William comes back for one last time in the abandoned location, the souls of his victims surround him. He is in the safe room where his spring Bonnie suit was put, so he decides to hide in it. However, the spring locks fail and he gets crushed inside of the suit. Michael is working as a technician in the underground location and tries to survive against his father's creations. He realizes that Circus Baby is possessed by his sister and that maybe she's trying to help. But that is not the case. All the animatronics combine into one being called Ennard and kill Michael. Their plan is to use him as a skin suit to escape. Their plan works, but after a while Michael's body starts to rot and to become of a purple color. Ennard comes out and goes into the sewers, and Michael comes back to life thanks to the Remnant. He wants to find his father and stop him. After his experience at Freddy's and Circus Baby's, Michael gets a security logbook. In this logbook, a spirit is writing questions, and one of them is, "Do you have dreams?" Michael answers this question with a drawing of a nightmarish version of Fredbear. In fact, Michael is dreaming nightmarish versions of the animatronics, and he's a child in these dreams. It's theorized that this is happening due to him remembering the death of his brother and guilt. However, it was revealed that the house where Michael is in his dreams is actually fake and is an experiment chamber created by his father connected to Circus Baby's Entertainment and Rental to test the fear level of children. The animatronics are nothing more than costumes hanging on flimsy metallic skeletons being moved by rails, and hallucinogenic gas is used to make the children see them as monsters. It is still unclear if William experimented on Michael, or if he has memories of someone else. Shadow Freddy, however, seems to be involved and might be the reason why Michael has those dreams. 30 years after Freddy's closed, a horror attraction about the stories of the franchise is about to open. Stuff found in the abandoned location gets brought there. Until they find the spring Bonnie suit and bring it with them too, without knowing what's inside. William Afton comes back as Spring Trap and tries to kill the night guard in that location. The night guard is also having hallucinations of past characters. After 6 nights, the location burns down due to faulty wiring. William, however, survives. Meanwhile, the animatronics and Ennard eject Baby from the body after an argument. Funtime Freddy takes control of Ennard and Circus Baby tries to fix herself. After years of absence, Henry returns with a plan. He opens the Freddy Fazbear's Pizza Place and hopes to attract the remaining animatronics. Meanwhile, Michael decides to work there in hopes to find his father. Henry also creates an animatronic bear called Lefte, or Lefty in short, that is programmed to catch the puppet and bring it to the location. The plan works, and now Scrap Baby, Molten Freddy, Lefty and William Afton are in the location, but in an underground labyrinth. Henry then sets fire to the location and hopes to put an end to everything, with him inside and Michael, who wanted to stay. However, A vengeful spirit is taking revenge on William Afton, keeping him alive even after that fire, while torturing him in some sort of never-ending nightmare in which William needs to survive against more than 50 animatronics. After the Freddy Fazbear's Pizza Place from the sixth game burned down, William Afton's corpse was found and brought to a hospital. People didn't know how was he even alive in those conditions. Some who worked in that hospital tried to end his sufferings, but they couldn't. They thought that an evil presence was doing all of that because a shadow of a child with a crocodile mask kept appearing every time they tried to kill him. Afton was also having horrible nightmares and was afraid of even hearing the word hell. The nightmares were the ultimate custom night, and the one who was tormenting him was the one he shouldn't have killed, who was a child named Andrew. William Afton spells out with his hand that he wants to go to the Fazbear Entertainment Distribution Center. The man is put in a wheelchair and they bring him to the distribution center. When they're inside, the man starts to violently convulse, spewing blood and tissue before collapsing. The man begins barfing, and then he explodes, spraying black blood and a tar-like substance everywhere. His remains fall out of the wheelchair and they hear something running towards the shelving area, and they find a trail of small footprints engraved in the man's blood and fluids. Both Andrew and William infected the objects in the center, but mainly a dog animatronic named Fetch. Meanwhile, a child named Jake has a brain tumor that he is fighting for 3 years already. His dad made a doll for him called Simon who became Jake's friend, but it was actually just his dad speaking through it. The situation gets worse and Jake dies, and Simon is nowhere to be found. Phineas Taggart, a retired scientist, now studies the power of human emotions. He hypothesizes how emotions are more powerful than any sort of physical matter, and can have a direct impact on inanimate objects depending on what emotion is thrown at them, thus explaining the concept of haunted objects. He was particularly focused on agony, the emotion he considered the most powerful of them all. He found Fetch and Simon. During one of his experiments, Phineas inserted the battery pack of Fetch into an animatronic endoskeleton. He also puts the head of the Simon doll onto the head of the endoskeleton. The endoskeleton comes to life and kills Phineas in cold blood. The police are called and it's presumed Phineas was electrocuted to death by his own equipment. Some of his belongings are eventually packed up, including the endoskeleton. The mysterious being awakens, putting on an old trench coat as the truck drives away. The endoskeleton is currently possessed by two boys, Jake and Andrew. Jake has control over the endoskeleton's sight and movement, while Andrew can only listen in. Both boys have foggy memories, but Andrew can recall wanting to get back at someone who hurt him. He had attached his soul to the man to ensure he never died, even when several people tried to kill him. Jake accidentally killed a man when he touched him when they were escaping. His skin turned pale and his eyes bleed black as he died. Andrew explains that his anger was affecting the endoskeleton and zapping anyone it touched, with the zap being capable of killing people. Andrew also reveals that a number of items were infected by that anger. Jake theorizes that there may be a third entity within the endoskeleton, a hitchhiker, which is causing the infection. Jake is able to telepathically connect to Andrew's thoughts, so that he can track down all the infected items. People started seeing them going around collecting stuff and called the creature the Stitch Wraith. A detective named Larson was sent to investigate on this case. The objects were mostly parts of the antagonists of most of the Fazbear Frights stories, like a strange plush trap chaser and a strange doll-looking animatronic with a long neck. Larson investigates in Phineas' laboratory. After connecting the dots, Larson concludes that the Stitch Wraith is connected to Fetch, who was connected to Fazbear Entertainment, where several murders had taken place. He then decides to search for more evidence to confirm his suspicions. The Stitch Wraith brings all the items in a warehouse where there is a large garbage compactor. Larson finds them and points his gun to the creature. Andrew tries to take control and to kill him, but Jake doesn't want to kill an innocent person, so he tries to stop Andrew. Jake activates the garbage compactor with all the items inside of it and jumps inside. Something really bad happens. While the two souls try to help each other, a strange colorful blob appears and attacks Andrew. The entity then takes the form of a skeletal man with pointy rabbit ears. It's William Afton. Andrew gets released from the Stitch Wraith, leaving only Jake. Afton uses all the infected objects and fuses with them, becoming a 15 feet tall monster. The Stitch Wraith comes out from the compactor, but it's not the only one. The doll-looking animatronic with the long neck goes to him and pins him to the ground and starts to absorb Afton's agony that was left in the Stitch Wraith. Then she goes to merge with the amalgamation. Larson gets attacked by Afton and gets stabbed with a metal part, but despite the wound he goes outside. He hears a voice from the Stitchwraith's bag. It's what remains of the puppet's mask. The Stitchwraith was often seen at the fire site, and that's how they found it. The voice tells him to bring it to Afton. Larson uses a forklift to pierce through Afton and push him towards a lake. The puppet comes to life and escapes the bag, as the mask and some newly formed limbs go inside of Afton's amalgamation. The doll-looking animatronic escapes from the amalgamation, while the puppet defeats Afton from the inside. The monster then collapses in the lake. Jake realized that Larson had been infected by Afton when he stabbed him, so he channels all of his energy from Fetch's battery pack into one of his arms and heats it up to the point where it shines. Jake takes his warm hand and burns away Afton's infection, also burning away some of Larson's flesh in the process. Jake hears police sirens, and leaves Larson to be rescued. Larson wakes up in a hospital. He's been having visions from different places and different times from different people. But, he always saw the same thing when transitioning between each memory, a ball pit. He begins to search for the ball pit because he felt it was connected to all the other mysteries, and wonders if the Stitchwraith is actually good and not evil. Days after the incident with Afton, Jake is all alone. He finds a homeless man and accidentally touches him, but this time he doesn't die. Instead, he sees his memories and finds out he can change them into happy ones. Jake then finds a girl and saves her from some men who were threatening her and decides to take care of her. Larson searches for potential places that might contain the ball pit and finally comes across an old, abandoned restaurant. The restaurant is bare and empty. He cautiously enters the ball pit and found it was similar to his visions. He discovers old blood and takes samples of it before leaving. Larson found 30 samples worth of blood in the ball pit. Larson receives the results of the blood samples which were tested in the lab. All 30 samples came from one person, with each sample coming from a different year. Larson deduces that something has been bleeding inside the ball pit for over 3 decades, and is determined to find the source. He suspects that it may tie back to the Stitchwraith and the weirdness surrounding it. Larson plans to learn once and for all whether the Stitchwraith is good or evil. The girl Jake has saved is called Renelle, and she tells him about her past and how she wants to reunite with her father. Jake notices that she's wearing a silver pendant in the shape of a heart. Larson discovers that while all the blood samples came from the same blood, the date of origin for each blood sample usually coincided with the disappearance of a teenager. Parents often reported that their teenager saw an animatronic with a female body and a pale face with clown makeup before disappearing. While looking through pictures of missing teenagers, he spots the animatronic behind one of them, wearing a heart-shaped pendant. Larson noticed another connection between the incidents while looking through the files. A man named Dr. Talbert was called in multiple times during a previous investigation. He specialized in studying a substance called Remnant, which looked like bubbling liquid mercury. The police department was never able to properly study it. Renelle finds the way to her father's house and Jake follows her. Her father is Dr. Talbert, however when Jake looked at a photo, she looked different there, so Renelle suddenly changes her appearance. Larson comes to Talbert's house too, and sees the Stitchwraith with a girl. All of a sudden, Larson begins to have another vision. He sees Renelle for who she truly is, Eleanor, an animatronic inhabited by a chaotic force that fed off of people's suffering. Larson draws out his gun to shoot her. Before he can, Renelle looks at him and smiles, as the visions overtake him and he collapses to the ground. He only manages to whisper her real name before losing consciousness. The Stitchwraith realized who she actually is and attacks her. Talbert thinks that the Stitchwraith is attacking his daughter. She makes a fake wound appear, and Talbert shoots him. Talbert tries to cure Renelle with Remnant. That's exactly what Eleanor wanted. Larson found himself in Eleanor's memories. She was the one behind most of the Fazbear Fright stories, and sees her creating the plush trap chaser and other antagonists of the stories. Suddenly Eleanor attacks him but Larson kills her, so he wakes up and sees that what he did in the memory affected the real Eleanor. Larson sees her. She has black tendrils made of blood shot out of her mouth and wrapped around his face, forcing him unconscious and back into her memories. Larson uses the ball pit and the memories to go to different ones and tries to change them with attacking Eleanor. The Stitchwraith is fueled with rage and finally stands up again, strangles her and burns her. Larson and Jake defeat Eleanor. Jake goes away, finds the ball pit in the abandoned location, and gives the victims happy memories. While Talbert explains to Larson what Remnant is, he gives Larson the heart-shaped pendant made from the real Renelle's Remnant.
Now it's time for the new storyline.
We have to go back to the past again. It all started with a man named Edwin Murray whose company was bought by Fazbear Enterprises. He was an engineer who was supposed to fix and create animatronics for the many Freddy Fazbear's locations. He had a 4-year-old son, David, who needed attention from him. but due to his job he almost never had time to do anything. One day Edwin had an idea, and for 22 days he worked non-stop to create an animatronic that was supposed to entertain David. The animatronic was made to learn through mimicking. Edwin gets this idea from how David's bed was built to mimic Tiger, David's favorite plush toy. Once finished, Edwin shows the endoskeleton to David and named it Mimic, based on the name of the program, Mimic 1. When Mimic was turned on, he mimicked David's actions. David was quick to learn how Mimic works and began to teach it how to play games. David taught Mimic more things. Mimic even watched them do other stuff such as wearing mascot costumes. Because Mimic couldn't speak, David taught it special hand movements to communicate. David often carried Tiger around, causing Mimic to curve his arms in a way that suggested he had his own. They even created a Tiger plush for him to hold. One day David chased a ball into the road and got hit by a white van. The world around Edwin begins to blur together as he mourns the death of his son. After 2 weeks, Mimic climbed up onto the table with his makeshift Tiger. Mimic set his Tiger aside and used the hand movements David taught him to ask for ice cream. Edwin snapped at the painful reminder of David, and he used a metal rod to repeatedly strike Mimic. He badly damaged him. Eventually Edwin ran out of strength and his anger turned into regret as he cried. Edwin then disappeared for years. Since the company had no news of Edwin for months, they sent a team to clean and repair the mess Edwin made. They fixed and upgraded the Mimic, but he started killing them all since he learned violence from Edwin. The company kept sending teams until they finally had their hands on the Mimic and his program. They liked the Mimic. So they decided to make an entire line of Mimic endoskeletons all with the same program, like if they were a hive mind. They put them in hidden spots of the locations to watch the animatronics perform since it was cheaper than programming their performances every time. Mimic endos were made to change their forms to fit every type of costumes. However, all of the Mimic endoskeletons got scrapped because they were dangerous and saw things they shouldn't have seen. It is speculated that one of them saw Spring Bonnie luring kids.
Fazbear Entertainment comes back under new management and tries to get a good reputation again. To do so, they hire an indie game developer to make games about the real events of the franchise, then proceed to discredit them and call the developer a lunatic that creates childish ghost stories. So Fazbear Entertainment decides to create a video game based on these stories to profit on them. To speed up the process, they scan old animatronic circuit boards that were found. It's a VR game. Also, they changed development teams a few times.
During the making of the Freddy Fazbear's virtual experience, the company wanted to use vintage circuit boards to program the animatronics' performances and routines better. They didn't know, however, that one of the circuit boards came from a Mimic endoskeleton. The Mimic 1 program learned informations from the game, and with the possible Spring Bonnie performance one of them had seen in the past, Glitch Trap was created.
After finding the anomaly, a beta tester makes tapes about what is happening in the company and what the virus is doing. Another beta tester named Jeremy played the game. He experienced nightmares and seemed to be talking to someone while playing. According to the other beta tester, Jeremy seemed to have lost control and may have cut his own face off with a guillotine paper slicer, while the company was deciding to fire him. So the other beta tester tries to find a way to delete the virus and hides all the tapes in the game for the next beta tester. The new beta tester is a person named Vanessa who finds all the tapes. However, the virus seems to be attached to the tapes, so the previous beta tester says to not collect them all. But it's too late. The virus tries to take control of Vanessa through the VR headset, and is successful. She has now a second personality named Vanny who is under his control. Fazbear Entertainment creates a delivery service called the Fazbear Funtime Service, which sends copies of animatronics to people who are subscribed to it. However, the virus has infected the animatronics and they're now aggressive. Vanessa works for this service but then gets moved to a new location as a security guard.
When the Mega Pizzaplex was still under construction, the company wanted to turn the Freddy Fazbear's Pizza Place into a museum. A van with the new generation of animatronics was sent to the workers so they can use the bots to help with their work. They chose a strange endoskeleton that looked like it survived a fire, it had bent metal ears that looked like antennas, and they thought he was a guitarist. They didn't know, however, that it was the mimic. They programmed him to break off the limbs and heads of animatronic parts and endoskeletons that they didn't need and to pile them up. At first he was working as intended, but then, he started to do that with humans. He killed lots of workers and the survivors sealed the entrance with concrete. One day some teenagers decided to go inside of the location through a vent opening. When they found the pile of corpses and animatronics, they wanted to escape, but they couldn't, and were trapped there. The mimic proceeded to kill them in different ways, such as luring them in a room through a radio while mimicking a person asking for help, and hiding while wearing different mascot costumes. He even turned into some sort of spider with 9 legs, with one of them coming out of his mouth and one of his eyes on one of them. Some time later, Vanny used Glamrock Freddy to clear the path to the pizza place, finally opening the entrance again.
I know what this is. I have been here before. She brought me here. I found myself for the first time when I cleared the path. I did not want to. But I had no choice.
They find a massive pile of animatronics and other stuff sleeping, speculated to be the pile of animatronics and corpses that the mimic created, called the Blob or the Tangle, now come to life. It seems that Vanny put Glitch Trap in the endoskeleton, finally creating Burn Trap. The spring body parts are speculated to come either from what remains of William Afton's costume or from a Springtrap cosplay from the cosplay area of the Pizzaplex. Or maybe it's just another spring body suit entirely. In the first few years of the Pizzaplex, it was decided to create a structure that looks like a tree in the middle of the Pizzaplex, with its root connected to the AIs of attractions and animatronics. Inside of the tree there was the storyteller, with a program that helped the AIs and told stories. After years, Edwin came back and worked in the Pizzaplex. He was the one who proposed to make the tree look like a baobab, however he didn't know what was inside of it. What he found brought back horrible memories. They put a white tiger head in the tree. So he began searching what program they used for the storyteller. It was the Mimic One program. He learned that it was used for VR, AR, and arcade games too. He snuck inside of the tree every night. The chairman of the Pizzaplex found out about that and trapped Edwin inside of the tree. When he went to check the tree after not hearing Edwin anymore and after regretting what he had done, he found out that Edwin died because there was no oxygen. The storyteller then closed the door and trapped him there too, making him die in the same way. The tree was then removed after 3 weeks, but the damage was already done. All of the attractions and animatronics were infected. The animatronics' personalities got amplified because of that.
To make things even worse, a child and a skilled hacker named Gregory, usually called Dr. Rabbit or GGY, hacked the Glamrock animatronics too, and killed people who got too close to the truth about who put a glitch in the bots, usually using the Glamrocks, mostly Freddy Fazbear himself. It's theorized that he was under Glitchtrap's control too. One day when the Glamrocks are performing, Freddy starts glitching out after spotting someone in the crowd, possibly GGY, and collapses on the ground. Freddy is now on safe mode, making him not corrupted, and Gregory uses him to hide in his stomach hatch before he wakes up because he doesn't want Vanessa to find him. Both Gregory and Freddy don't seem to remember what they did together in the past, or maybe Gregory is just hiding the truth from him. Since the location is closed, Freddy wants to help him escape, while the other corrupted Glamrocks try to get him. However, Gregory is very brave and finds ways to destroy Chica, Roxanne and Monty because he wants to upgrade Freddy with their parts. When Gregory gets the chance to escape, he chooses to stay and investigate, since they found Vanny's hideout during the night. Gregory and Freddy go against Vanny. She orders the other bots to disassemble Freddy, while Gregory tries to run to her hideout.
Gregory saves Vanessa from Glitchtrap's control by playing the Princess Quest arcade machines, finally defeating him. It seems that this caused the mimic to become normal again. Gregory and Vanessa went to the Freddy Fazbear's pizza place, now located in a sinkhole under Roxy's Raceway. They sealed the mimic in the basement by sealing the entrance with concrete again. Gregory and Vanessa proceeded to install Mexas, a security program that was supposed to keep the mimic contained and hidden. Gregory, Vanessa, and Freddy thought everything was over. However, that was not the case. The events of ruin happen. The Pizzaplex collapsed because something tunneled out of the sinkhole, breaking everything. It's likely that it happened because Gregory and Vanessa went to the pizza place and woke the blob up. In fact, it can be found on the surface now. A little girl named Cassie, who is Gregory's friend, got a message from him, saying that he is trapped under the Pizzaplex. She can communicate with Gregory through a walkie-talkie and later on receives a mask that looks like Vanny's. It's a security mask connected to the Vanny network, it has AR technology. Gregory says that to get to him, she needs to deactivate security nodes, however that causes Mixes to intervene. Sadly, the last security node to deactivate is her favorite animatronic, Roxanne Wolf. Cassie deactivates Mexas and destroys the concrete wall. However, that was not Gregory. The mimic is now free from his prison. Roxanne saves Cassie from the mimic for a bit, then the real Gregory speaks to her from the walkie-talkie explaining her everything. The mimic starts chasing Cassie. In the main ending, Cassie gets to an elevator, but Gregory says that they can't risk being followed, making the elevator fall with Cassie inside. It is debated if that's the real Gregory or the mimic again. In another ending, the mimic wears a mascot costume to resemble Gregory and gets scooped in a secret room.
This is all for now until Help Wanted 2 releases.
FNAF World is a spin-off game that appears rarely on timeline videos like this. It's an RPG game that seems to be completely disconnected to the main lore. However, if we speak to Fredbear and wait for a bit, he will start glitching and will tell us to find some clocks. It will be revealed that the clocks makes you create the secret minigames from Five Nights at Freddy's 3, which consist on giving the missing children's souls their happiest day. Old Man Consequences from Ultimate Custom Night actually first appeared in FNAF World, and in both of his mini-games, the only way to get out is to drown in a lake. Didi and Lalbit also first appeared in this game. Glamrock Bonnie does indeed exist, but he mysteriously disappeared in Monty Golf and got replaced by Montgomery Gator. In the Ruin DLC, a destroyed Glamrock Bonnie can be found behind a wall in Bonnie Bowl. It's theorized that Monty destroyed him to take his place, since he's really violent and destructive. Some fans still aren't sure about that, but most seem to have accepted this as the answer.
The names of the original missing children are Gabriel, Fritz, Susie, and Jeremy. The fifth child's name is Cassidy. The name can be found in the logbook. The Scooper, the thing that killed Michael, was actually used to inject Remnant in the animatronics. Fazbear Entertainment fires people by giving them stupid reasons. That's why Michael was fired for odor. It was just a joke, and not because he's a rotting corpse. Also, he wasn't a corpse during that time.
You can always tell when a company is getting ready to fire someone. They start giving out written warnings for silly things, making sure to build a paper trail and make a case for a firing. Things that normally no one would care about suddenly become grave offenses.
We don't know who is the night guard in the third game. He can be a random person, Hudson from the books, or Michael. If he's Michael, then the hallucinations make more sense, but only if he's Fritz in the second game, of course, and the fire may not have been an accident if this is the case. That's all, goodbye for now. See you next time.